Hello and welcome to Gower's Cricket Monthly. And for this final edition of the summer, we've come to Grace Road, Leicester, to watch my old county clinch their first championship title for over 20 years. And as we round up and review all the summer's key events and issues, don't worry, there's plenty more to keep you entertained.
We review a decidedly mixed summer for England after series against India and Pakistan. We hear from those men responsible and those charged with improving things this winter. Geoff Boycott adds his usual candid opinions on what's gone right and wrong for our lads in 1996. We have a feature on a unique club for those whose test appearance was also unique. And we pose the question on what's gone wrong with the Durham dream as the newest first-class county flounders in the championship.
But we start with the grand finale to the Britannic Assurance County Championship. When I first made it through these gates back in 1975, I was lucky enough to be part of the side that won the championship here for the first time in its history, led then by Ray Illingworth. Now, 21 years later, Leicester came to this last round of matches, perfectly placed to repeat the feat and take the title for a second time.
Hello, David. Hello, it's nice to see you back.
Nice
Thank
to see
you.
It.
Carry
nice
on.
With one game to go, Leicestershire stood atop the championship table, needing maximum bonus points and a draw to be sure of the title. Only Surrey and Kent realistically had the ability to topple the leaders, while the rest of the top teams were in there fighting for the prize money. Of the Leicester side of 75, only Jack Birkinshaw as coach remains connected with the club. But former captain Ray Illingworth has been admiring the efforts of current leader James Whittaker.
I think James done very well. He's an outgoing person. I think he's given them a little bit of confidence to play the shots, not be frightened, and he's let them play. And that's what I've always believed in, letting people play. You've got to be responsible, but you've also got to let them play as well.
Shot, Spider. It's got ice on it, that one.
That swing would serve Alan Mullally well against Middlesex. But as his men relaxed on the golf course before the final match, Whittaker had few doubts about the end result.
I mean, all the boys are well aware of what we need to do and what we're going to do. It's something that we've been gradually building up to for the last 4 or 5 weeks. We've been playing quality cricket, and we'll play quality cricket this week and win.
And win they did, with some style. Middlesex won the toss and batted first, but only Mark Ramprakash was able to resist, with 71 before mistiming a return catch to Gordon Parsons. David Milnes wrapped up the innings for a meagre 190. And despite the chill breeze, the Leicester Fox was running hot. In response, Phil Simmons led the way with a magnificent 142 not out. But the icing on the cake for the Grace Road faithful was a last wicket partnership of 112 with Alan Mullally, and that swing again, making a quick-fire 75. A lead of 322 was more than enough, but it was at tea time on the third day when news came through that Surrey had forfeited their first innings that it was first confirmed that Leicester were indeed champions.
Congratulations, the title comes back after 21 years in your first season as captain too.
Yeah, absolutely tremendous. It's been a brilliant season. I'm totally happy for all the boys that have participated in it. It's really wonderful.
Well, I know at the start of the summer everyone's optimistic, every captain, every committee, every playing staff say we're going to win a title. Is this really beyond belief?
Well, we always had a lot of belief in ourselves. So, Right from the off, we always believed we'd do well, and now obviously this is just the pinnacle of our belief, really. So, yeah, we've played well.
We've used 13 players. What's been the secret of the success?
Well, just that, really. I mean, we've been able to get a lot of spirit going because we've only used 13 players. And plus, everyone's been in form all the time, and it's always been, if someone hasn't done it, another person's done it, and so on and so forth. That's probably the main reason. And the spirit and the desire has always been there. It's been great.
Philip, come to you. Phil Simmons, you've been one of the outstanding men of this side as the overseas player, the hired gun. What does this title mean to you?
As I said before, I just can't find words to describe what it really means. You know what I mean?
It's great to come here and play cricket, but to win the county championship is just something different. Just according to bollocks, it's awesome.
And personally, you've got wickets, you've got runs, you've taken catches. Has this been some of the best cricket you've played?
I think, yeah, it's been consistently the best cricket I've played. I mean, with the guys, as Jimmy was saying, with the guys, when one day I don't perform or Jimmy doesn't perform, Ben Smith performs or Darren Maddy performs, and that's been great. I mean, you can assure yourself that with 20-something county championship centuries scored, every game somebody scored. It's only been, two games we haven't scored a century. And that's where I think we've done very well.
And one final word about this man then, the skipper?
It's a different story.
Same size, yeah.
The thing about it is that he lets everybody think the game, you know. And if you think in the game, then you're going to perform better instead of he just thinking for everyone. And I think that's been one of the keys to success.
Well, congratulations to both of you. Well done.
Thanks again.
And as the celebrations got underway, England bowler Alan Mullally agreed that a united team effort had been the key.
But it seems that everyone supported everyone else in the side.
Brilliant. Yeah, we've got five guys who've got 50 first-class wickets, there and thereabouts. Six guys who've got 1,000 runs each, so it's a big team effort. That's what it's all about.
While the dancing continued into the night at Grace Road, there was still work to be done elsewhere for the other contenders. Derbyshire's title hopes had vanished in their penultimate match at home to Warwickshire. A fractured shoulder as he walked into a bouncer kept Dominic Cork out of much of the match. And despite the efforts of Philip de Freitas and the remainder of the attack, Derby lost. But a comfortable victory against Durham in the final match meant a contented captain in Dean Jones.
We're quite happy. Everyone's rapt that we had a chance to go for the title. A lot of the teams don't get that chance, and we're glad to have experienced that chance. It's like probably a golfer walking up 18 and missing out on the last few putts. But there's been some great things that have come along this year with Derbyshire, and hopefully the people in Derbyshire will get behind us next year and have a real good crack at it again.
Surrey's challenge got stuck in the mud at the Oval. Heavy rain prevented any play until the second day, when Worcester captain Tom Moody further dampened the home side's hopes with a fluent 60. Even so, captain Alex Stewart was happy enough with his side's progress this season.
I think everyone's just realised, you know, we are a talented side, but I think in the past a lot of people have left the job to other people instead of taking on responsibility themselves. And this year we've done that, and each individual has done well, and at the same time it's been a very good squad effort. Got to remember we've had three or four players away for a lot of the season with England, so the unsung heroes, as I call them, have come and done a fine job.
And of course they did take home the AXA Equity and Law Trophy. To put themselves in prime position, it had taken a last gasp boundary from Martin Bicknell to clinch victory over early pace setters Northamptonshire in their last but one match. After the heady excitement of that finish, a more controlled victory at Glamorgan completed the formalities. Surrey's time in the wilderness without a trophy was finally over.
It's been a satisfactory year. Obviously nice to have finally won a trophy after a long break of near enough 14 years, I think. And if we can build on what we've done this year and carry on next year and a few years after that, then there's no reason why we can't be the premier county in the competition.
Although Notts finished equal on points, Surrey's superior run rate secured the title. Yorkshire were third. Back in the championship, Kent ended up fourth after a damp squib of a performance at Bristol, where they were twice bowled out cheaply, and with nothing in the trophy cabinet to show for their efforts, it wasn't good enough for captain Steve Marsh.
At the end of the day, we still haven't won a trophy, and every county must go out to win at least one trophy a season, and we haven't done that. So although it's been a pleasing performance in the championship, our one-day form hasn't been as good possibly as it was in the last couple of seasons. So next year, hopefully, we can combine the both, the four-day and the one-day, and win another trophy, because that, at the end of the day, is what counts.
One bright note was the performance of Dean Headley, who equaled the world record with three hat-tricks in the season, the last of which turned the match against Hampshire and brought a remarkable win. Essex, under Paul Pritchard, did well to sustain their challenge until the last week, largely thanks to the performances of a man, still at 43, the leading English batsman. An unbeaten 170 against Glamorgan failed to prevent a Welsh victory, but guaranteed him £10,000 as the White and Mackay Batsman of the Year.
This year I've had a particularly good season. Really enjoyed my cricket at Essex, in the county championship especially. And, you know, we've had a good season, the team, apart from the last week where we missed out in the final at NatWest and slipped away in the last couple of games of the championship. But the boys played pretty well, and it's nice to still be opening the batting and still making a big contribution.
He's a great player, he's an all-time great batsman. And, you know, he's a big asset to the side. And, you know, we've got to keep wheeling him out of there, haven't we?
Yorkshire had their best all-round season for many years. Sixth in the Championship, third in the Sunday League, and making it to the semi-final of both the B&H and the NatWest. Much of their success inspired by the batting and leadership of David Byas.
I think what we've achieved is, you know, players have generally enjoyed the cricket. I think, you know, we've wanted to go out there and play. I think with doing that, it's obviously brought, you know, performances up maybe 10-15%. Obviously, success through the season's kept us interested in other things as well. You know, the Championship, we've always been in contention of it, albeit we had a spell maybe 6-7 weeks ago when we lost three on the bounce, but we came back from that and we're still, you know, within grasping distance of it.
It also helped that the ebullient Darren Goff regained his fitness, confidence, form, and finally his England place. He was the White and Mackay Bowler of the Year. So, the final Britannic Assurance table shows Leicester clear winners by 27 points in one of the tightest finishes for years. Last year's champions Warwickshire were eighth. In the bottom half, Lancashire's powerful one-day side could manage only two championship wins, while Durham's dismal season left them bottom, 199 points behind the champions. Lancashire can be proud of their two trophies. First, the Benson and Hedges, which they claimed back in July. They won the NatWest final in dramatic fashion. Defending 186, they routed Essex for 57, comfortably the lowest score in a final. Man of the match, Glenn Chappell, taking 6 for 18.
Well, there's another one. Given him. And that is the finish.
While Mike Watkinson should be happy clutching these two trophies, even though his captaincy is reportedly under threat and the club are still looking for a new coach, there are no consolation prizes for his counterparts at Durham. To find out exactly what's going wrong up there, we sent Simon Hughes to investigate.
The championship title kept us guessing till the last weekend. It has been known for some time that Durham would come bottom of the table. So I was sent off 3 weeks ago to give them this. Thank God their last match wasn't at home. Mind you, I'd better get a bit of a shift on, because some of their games don't last all that long.
At least Durham's beleaguered batsmen dragged the match against Derby into a third day, but couldn't break a depressing sequence of events, casting them well adrift at the foot of the table and adding to the furrows on Geoff Cook's brow.
It's tough. Tough to watch. It's tough when we watch ourselves bat. You live and breathe every ball that you bowl and bat, and you go home at night an absolute nervous wreck. And sometimes I find myself turning away. So you just got to grin, bear it, hope the tide will turn.
In Durham's first-class infancy, a host of seasoned stars were imported to give the team initial credibility. Ian Botham stood and delivered as only he can. The stroke play of Wayne Larkins captivated everyone except the opposing bowlers. And the vision to create a test-class stadium in the northeast gradually became a reality. Now they need to build a confident team around the perseverance of caretaker captain Simon Brown.
As the season's gone on, we've got a little bit better. We've batted a little bit better in patches, but again, we seem to lose wickets in a bit of a glut, really. We seem to lose three or four quickly together. As you know yourself, obviously, playing four-day cricket, it's very difficult to fight back from that.
When I left Middlesex, the only reason I did leave was because I wanted to become captain, and by chance it was of my home county. That was a very proud moment, and obviously when I made the decision to stand down, it was a very difficult one, but unfortunately it just didn't work out.
Young talent like dashing batsman Paul Collingwood and bustling fast bowler Melvin Betts is emerging, but they need a distinguished figure to look up to.
Teams who've sort of struggled perhaps for sort of 3 or 4 years, then one player comes along and just seems to make a massive difference. The rest of the team just seems to feed off that. Hopefully somebody like David Boone, when he comes, the rest of the team might be able to sort of raise the level a little bit to try and compete a bit more.
The battling Boone arrives next summer to captain Durham and transform their fortunes, as he did for Tasmania.
Basically, over the last 2 years, they haven't done very well. They've been in way down the bottom in their placings at the end of the season. But as I understand it, they've got a very young side, which in talking to their coach, Geoff Cook, it appears that they're very similar to what Tasmania was a few years back, where we have a lot of potential there, a lot of guys with a bit of talent. But they sort of a little bit of a lack of self-belief, and hopefully we can help them produce what they're capable of. I suppose the most difficult thing for me is going to be that I only really know one of the guys, John Morris, I've played against before, so I'm going to have to get to know them very quickly, and alternatively they'll have to get to know me pretty quick as well. I can assure that everyone there that I'll be giving it all my best shot, and just not going over there to experience county cricket. That I've signed up and adopted Durham as my county side, so they'll be getting 150%, the same as anybody would here.
In the northeast, locals are desperate to retain their first-class status.
When Durham first got into the championship, I mean, that in itself was an achievement, and people turned up just to see the big names on their doorstep. But after 5 years, it's beginning to wear a little thin.
As for John Morris and Rosebery, most right-thinking people feel a great deal of sympathy for them. Notwithstanding, they've sickened us one time and another. Team selection hasn't always been what we would have hoped, as we say the game.
We've got lads who were playing in this last game who've played more first-team games and second-team games. So the introduction to first-class cricket has been very quick, in some cases too quick, very stark, and very difficult because we haven't played well, because probably of the inexperience to a large extent. But they'll learn, be better cricketers for it.
More than the occasional total of 300-plus should be possible next year to gain respect and avoid a fourth wooden spoon.
Thankfully, I haven't had to accept too many myself, but I think you can have it back, yours.
So, that's the highs and lows of the county scene sorted out. But what of England? Well, it's been a bit of a rollercoaster ride this year for both them and their supporters, and they must do well this winter in Zimbabwe and New Zealand in preparation for next year's major series against Australia. Here now are Jonathan Agnew's reflections on England in 1996.
Four more runs, the winning hit, and England's dismal trot in the World Cup continues. We began to wonder when England would win a match, but the summer's over and it hasn't been all bad by any means. Although the bowling remains short of a world-class wicket-taker, England's top six of Atherton, Stewart, Hussain, Thorpe, Crawley and Knight must match any batting lineup in the world. Despite a brief and rather farcical attempt to overthrow him, Ray Illingworth remained in charge for one last summer. David Graveney and Graham Gooch joined him after a controversial election of the selectors, and the new face as England coach was David Lloyd, who was given a six-month trial in the hot seat.
He's a great enthusiast, is Lloydie, and that's important to any side. I did say to him at the start that it's good being enthusiastic if we're playing well. It's difficult to say how great we are when we're playing badly, and I think he realised that before the summer was out.
After 3 years, England were given the chance to avenge their 3-0 thrashing in India, and Graham Hick opened his shoulders to get the Texaco trophy off to a flying start. A revitalised Chris Lewis returned to the international arena. And his Surrey teammate Alistair Brown scored a century in his last innings for England. The disappointments of the World Cup seemed a long way away.
And I thought we played in great style against India in the one-day competition, and we were at pains to say, when I say we, the selectors, that this team is specific to one-day cricket, and I thought we achieved very well.
Meanwhile, the cold and wet weather was playing havoc with India's preparations, and chilly was the best way to describe Azza's relations with Sidhu, the opening batsman, who flew home in a huff. England's bowlers, led by Cork, dominated the first test. Cork, sadly, lost confidence as the summer progressed, and by the end had lost his place. Hussain was given the chance to relaunch his career.
Big shout. Daryl Hare shakes his head. Debagal Srinath cannot believe it.
Replay suggests that Hussain had a stroke of luck and the ball certainly appeared to flick the glove. But Hussain has made the number three spot his own and is England's vice-captain this winter. It might have been a very different story.
That'll do nicely. Nasser Hussain has his maiden Test match 100.
Sachin Tendulkar did all he could to dig India out of their hole with a truly brilliant century. He made 122 out of 219 all out, the next highest score being 18.
He's gone from 94 to 100 with the most beautiful hit down the ground. You won't see a better innings than that this year.
It didn't stop England winning by 8 wickets, but in the background there was an unwelcome distraction. Ray Illingworth was fined £2,000 and found guilty of bringing the game into disrepute. The Lord's Test was Dickie's farewell, and there wasn't a dry eye in the house. Perhaps that was Mike Atherton's problem, because the crowd had barely sat down again before Dickie was pressed into action.
Well, there's a tester for Dickie Bird, and he's given it. Michael Atherton out, LBW in the first over of the day.
England's first innings lent heavily on Jack Russell's second Test century. He made a typically dogged 124 and seemed set for a full summer behind the stumps. Sourav Ganguly entered the record books as one of a very select band to score a century in his first Test innings. And when Hick was dismissed in the second innings on the last day, England were in all sorts of trouble.
If my memory's right, at lunchtime, we were about 85 for six. Another young kid in, Irani. Ronnie Irani, who's he? Well, he's up for it for a start. You know, he rises to every challenge. And I'm not interested in what he can't do. I'm more interested in what he can do, and he can work on other areas of his game. But he joined with Jack Russell, who loves a fight. Russell loves a scrap, great character, extrovert, and they played for England, and they did us proud, and they batted for a long time and took the game into safer waters, so I was really pleased. That's one aspect of the season that really pleased me, that we got stuck in there when we could have folded, and we got what we deserved in a draw from the game.
The Trent Bridge Test was Azharuddin's last as captain of India. He's now been replaced by Tendulkar. And Ganguly emulated Azhar by scoring another century in his second Test. Tendulkar, relishing playing Test cricket, made 177, and India rattled up 521. They needed quick wickets.
Oh, dropped him.
Atherton, who'd been going through a bad trot, dropped on naught, and he made India suffer, scoring 160 in nearly 8 hours. Hussain scored his second century of the series before breaking a finger, and the match was drawn to give England the series 1-0, their first win for 2 years.
I heard that we caught them cold. We get caught hot when we go to India. They're here. They're to play cricket. They didn't want to come. They should have stopped at home. You know, we beat them and beat them well, and our preparation was spot on.
A great start for the new coach, but Pakistan were always going to provide a stiffer challenge, and the sports editors hoped a ball-tampering headline or two.
We got a very friendly side. We have all the same age group. The boys are going to enjoy their cricket. I think England also picked up the young side. So it'll be a very good competition. I'm looking forward to it, and probably others are looking forward to it as well.
That smile was never far from Wasim's face, but a previous captain of Pakistan had other things on his mind. The frailty of the laws of cricket were ruthlessly exposed in the High Court. There isn't a sport on earth which could stand such an examination, and it's all going to happen again next summer. A couple of miles away at Lord's, Inzamam was bludgeoning his way to a mighty century.
Catch!
Mullally. He needs to be 12 feet tall, not 6. 100 up, nice way to do it.
Here's an example of an unwelcome intrusion by modern technology. The giant replay screen at the ground showed 29,000 people that umpire Willie made a mistake and gave this leg byes. Had the catch been taken, he wouldn't have allowed it. Sooner or later, there'll be an incident. Test umpires need supporting, not exposing. England's hopes of survival rested with Atherton and Stewart. They appear to have made the game safe at lunch, but after the break, 9 wickets fell for only 75 runs. Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone, and another one gone. Another one bites the dust. Hey, I'm gonna get to two. Another one bites the dust. A triumphant Wasim was one up, and the Leeds crowd seemed prepared for another pantomime performance. They got it too, England's worst day of the whole summer. The bowling was woeful, and Ejaz, feeding on anything short, cut and pulled his way to 141 to push England out of the match. Alex Stewart, restored to opening, replied with 170 to complete a remarkable personal transformation. And at number 6, Nick Knight appeared to enjoy reaching 3 figures for England for the first time. And so to the Oval, with England needing to win to square the series. A batsman's paradise, apparently, and John Crawley clearly enjoyed it, scoring his maiden Test century. Robert Croft quickly took his first Test wicket and did enough to book a place on the tour. But then it all went horribly wrong again for England, as Mushtaq wreaked havoc. Yes! He took 6 for 78, and fittingly, Wasim Akram wrapped it all up.
That's it. 300 Test wickets for Wasim Akram.
Quite a milestone, and Pakistan won 2-0.
I felt if we... If we halved it with Pakistan, that would be reasonably good, because I think there's no doubt about it, they've got 3 world-class bowlers. And any side with 3 world-class bowlers are going to cause you problems in Test matches. No doubt about that. If they play against the Aussies or anybody else, they'll cause them problems in Test matches. So that was going to be a problem. And we found out to be right. We didn't make enough runs, and that's the answer.
At least England came back to clinch the Texaco trophy. Adam Holyoake seized his opportunity, with the ball at least, and he'll captain the A Tour of Australia this winter. And Nick Knight showed his versatility, not to mention fitness, by scoring back-to-back centuries.
Well, pleased with the first half of the summer, pleased to win this Texaco Trophy Series. Obviously very disappointed with the way we played in the Test Match Series against Pakistan. It showed that we've still some way to go. We need to find a couple of match-winning bowlers, if you like, because the batsmen can't forever be, you know, backs to the wall and fighting off draws. But what we've got is a winter ahead against Zimbabwe and New Zealand to develop a nucleus of players, hopefully, who can, you know, have a go at the Australians next summer.
And these are the 15 players to tour this winter. Irani won the battle for the all-rounders position. There's a recall for Tufnell, a tremendous opportunity for Silverwood, and the new vice-captain.
It's something that I'm very proud of, and, you know, I'll continue to help Athers out like I have done in the past. But as I say, you know, my feet are firmly on the ground, and I realise if I stop scoring runs, things like that will go. And I'm just going to concentrate scoring runs for England. And whenever Michael or anyone else in the England dressing room needs a bit of help or advice, I'll try and do that as well.
No one's ever doubted that Tufnell's the best we've got. But will he behave this time?
Obviously, you do things in your career that you look back on and think you could have done better or shouldn't have done. And I agree that I've perhaps done a few things that, on reflection, were a bit silly or a little bit stupid. I intend to put them behind me now and move on and show this trip that I have changed and are looking forward to going over and playing some good cricket for England.
This is the one new face, Yorkshire's Chris Silverwood.
I was on my golf course when I actually found out about it. And I went in and looked at CFAX, and to see my name next to the full England squad, I was very surprised.
The A-team go to Australia. I fancy Mark Butcher, Andrew Harris and Ashley Giles to make names for themselves. And there's a place for Essex's destroyer in the NatWest final, Glen Chapel.
We've won three series, two one days and a test series against India. We've had a reversal against Pakistan. And our next challenge is Zimbabwe, New Zealand, which we need to win. And then next summer Australia come, and I know that everybody is saying that it's next summer that matters. Of course it is. It's the old enemy we're playing against them. And everybody will be up for it. Take my word, we'll be ready for them.
Well, England will be without Ray Illingworth, of course. He's headed off to his retirement villa in Spain. But not before, quite rightly, he won his appeal.
You know, I've been in this game 45 years. I've put a lot into it. I've never gone for big money or anything like that. OK, I like to have a nice living, but money's never been the main thing. But it did mean a lot to me that I wasn't bringing this game into disrepute. I felt it was a ridiculous decision in the first place, and it pleased me no end when it was rescinded.
So, England move on, albeit without Raymond. Gone, but not forgotten, certainly as far as those here at Grace Road are concerned. And nor should we forget the immense overall contribution he's given to English cricket over many, many years. Now it's time for another Yorkshireman to give his closing address, at least for this summer. Here's Geoffrey.
Now, what about this summer for England? Well, it started off very well, didn't it? New coach, David Lloyd, came in with new ideas and a lot of optimism. He had them songs in the dressing room and a bit of rah-rah-rah, some Winston Churchill speeches, but it didn't make any difference. We flattered to deceive against India, had a good series against a moderate side, but when we got some tough opposition, Pakistan came along, we bottled it, we folded, didn't we? And the fact of life is, doesn't matter what coach we have, what sort of songs we have in the dressing room, or none at all for me, the players aren't good enough. We're at the bottom of the test match ladder. And when it comes to the particular players, I think the disappointments of the summer for most people should have been Chris Lewis. Here's a man with extraordinary talent who flattered, gave us a glimpse of what he's capable of against India, then it all petered away, and that's happened too often in Chris Lewis's career. And I'm afraid because it's happened too often, it may be the finish of him playing for England. I thought on top of that, Salisbury didn't bowl very well. We won't see him in the test side for a while. Too many long hops, full tosses, too many easy deliveries that he has to get out of his system to make a test match cricketer. Now, what about the pluses? That's more important. I thought Hussain played really well. That's a plus for the coming winter. Young Nick Knight, very good cricketer, very good hands in the slips. I think he'll get better. Croft, a good test match. I picked him a year ago to play for England. It took him a year to get round to it, the selectors. Mullally had a steady series, quite impressed with him. But at the same time, I think he's got to bowl a yard quicker. He's got to bend his back and realise that he can't bowl as a stock bowler in test match cricket and get two or three wickets. He's now got to become a match winner, get five or six for us and up his pace. But perhaps, even after that, the real plus of the summer was Alex Stewart. He was a guy that Raymond Illingworth had booted out, said, well, he might not play again. Through Nick Knight's injury, he got an opportunity and he grabbed it with both hands, made more runs than anybody. Huge century at Headingley, and he should be there now for some time. But he's a strong character, Alec, and maybe just now and again, if the management are listening, he needs a little kick up the backside. I think the debate would have come about Ronnie Irani, who got the nod over Elam. Elam's a bowler who swings it, had quite a good test match until he got injured. Irani, he played very well with the bat. His bowling needs some improvement, but they've gone for Irani. I don't mind that. He's a cocky, confident cricketer, very positive cricketer. I think he'll improve and do quite well if he's given opportunities. I think the real debate would have come with the England bowling. It was atrocious this year at times, wasn't it? And there isn't much to go on where you could point your finger and say, put him in. Is better than what we've got. So there will have been long, long debates on people like Devon Malcolm, who at 34 couldn't get back in the side, and I think that's gone against him. I don't think it's Raymond Illingworth being offhand or still trying to keep him out of the side because of their disagreement in Cape Town last winter. I think it's purely that they're not sure he can keep his consistency of pace and accuracy at 34 years of age, and so that's why Chris Silverwood of Yorkshire's got an opportunity. They've looked around for other fast bowlers, there aren't any. So they've taken the young Yorkshire boy, who's the young cricketer of the year. He swings it, hits the deck, right attitude, right age at 21, can improve, should get better. And then we come to the spinners. Tufnell. Tufnell's on everybody's names. He's even on his missus's names. You know, nobody can ever forget Tufnell. Whenever you pick an England cricket team, you have to think of Philip Tufnell and why he doesn't get picked. Well, it's long overdue. I'm delighted he's in the side, and I hope he does well. Well, it should be easy, shouldn't it, playing against Zimbabwe? They're supposed to be the newcomers, bottom of the league. But I wouldn't put my house on England beating Zimbabwe with the way we've been playing in recent tours. And then New Zealand. New Zealand are tough cookies on their own surfaces. They're not easy to beat. They're a funny sort of itsy-bitsy players. They don't have any great players. They're not going through a great stage in their cricket at the moment. And so you should say, well, England have a great opportunity to do well there. But let me tell you, I don't care who you are, how much you support England, there's a lot we're waiting for to happen in the England team this winter. We're waiting for them to show us that they're ready for Australia come next summer. I'm not so sure that we're going to do that well, but I hope so.
And our thanks as ever to Mr. Boycott. Now, Geoffrey and I were both privileged enough to win several of these. It's an England cap. Graham Gooch has most with 118. Geoffrey and I weren't far behind. But at the other end of the scale are several players who weren't given quite the same extended chance, as Fiona Stephenson now reports.
Graham Gooch retired last year from Test cricket, having played 118 times for England, just one ahead of David Gower's previous record, and 10 matches in front of Geoffrey Boycott. Last week, he joined a select group of players who each have 117 caps fewer than him, as they celebrated the formation of the One Test Wonders Club. Chairman John Stephenson explained why.
The main object of it is to have fun, get everyone together, discuss some stories. But the more serious side to it is to play charity games in future for the cricketers that have played one test who are still able to play cricket.
John's sole appearance to date started unpromisingly when he was met by the chairman of selectors.
I was very nervous. Turned up the day before, actually, for practice. And I remember getting to the ground just a little bit late. So I was a bit lost, and I went up to the dressing room, and Ted Dexter greeted me with, "What are you doing here, lad?" And I said, "Well, you know, I've been selected to play tomorrow." And he said, "Well, what's your name?" "So it's John Stephenson." He said, "Oh, right, okay. You better go down into the dungeon then and get changed."
At least he had the chance to make a few runs, unlike the unfortunate Alan Wells, who made his long-awaited debut last summer and lasted just one delivery.
And one ball's enough. Curtly Ambrose strikes, 2-2. What a disappointment for Alan Wells, what a disappointment for England.
Equally disappointed was Wells' former Sussex teammate, Paul Parker. He also failed to trouble the scorers in his first test innings.
Towards the end of the day, Brearley said, "You know, Paul, you've been sitting with your pads all day. Look, don't worry. The new ball's due. If a wicket falls, I'll go in. You have a rest." I thought, "Oh, that's great. You know, I don't have to do this anymore." And Brearley went in. Brearley came out. I went in. I came out. That was as simple as that, really.
Second inning, same story. Caught Kent, bowled Alderman, this time for 13.
Since then, I almost feel cheated because I've done it once. I wanted to have another go. I mean, it was wrong. I wanted to prove, you know, I wanted to show what I could do, really. Still, I mean, that's by the by.
Probably the unluckiest member of the club joined in 1984. Andy Lloyd opened in the first test against the West Indies at Edgbaston, got hit on the head by Marshall, retired hurt for 10, was absent from the second innings and was never asked back. Andy is one of 83 players capped just once for England. One of the oldest of the 20 living members is 82-year-old Norman Mitchell Innes. He represented England against South Africa at Trent Bridge in 1935. However, chronic hay fever put a stop to his test career, and he had to decline his next invitation to play for England, believing he wouldn't do his country justice due to his incessant and off-putting sneezing in the field. Former Yorkshire and Man United player Arnie Sidebottom retired early from his test at Trent Bridge when he broke his toe.
Just to get picked for England were incredible, really. I mean, I was picked for England when I was probably past it, to be fair. I played professional football for 10 years, so it was really difficult. Like I say, I just went back to play for Yorkshire in the break in the football season, which in the early 70s and 80s were like 3 or 4 months, you know, so which is totally different today.
Leg at a can out.
Turned in a bit. Dick Richardson after it.
Truman coming in to Worrell. Worrell on 99.
Frank Worrell went on to carry his bat for a brilliant 191. In the field that day were the Richardson brothers, Peter, who played 34 tests, and his younger brother and club member, Dick.
It was a great innings, actually, because I don't know how many overs he bowled, but a considerable number. I would have thought probably 40 or 50 overs. Then to go in and open the batting and bat all the way through, and then open up again the second innings, it was remarkable.
Tony Pigott's debut was also remarkable. Plucked from club cricket in Wellington as a replacement, the fact that he got a wicket with his seventh ball and England were twice bowled out for less than 100 by New Zealand was nothing compared to the timing of his unexpected call from the selectors.
He said, you know, are you doing anything this weekend? I said, yes, I am, actually. He said, well, is there anything that can be put off? And I said, well, I don't know, I'll see. He said, what are you doing? I said, I'm getting married. I'm getting married on Sunday. So he said, oh, right. Well, I said, no, I'll be there. So I actually postponed my marriage to play for England the next day.
And that's out. Butcher goes. Nicely caught by Venkat at third slip. Another laser shot. And does that mean that Alan Butcher has missed his chance of a trip this winter?
Well, Alan did miss out on the subsequent winter tour, but not on the recognition and fame that comes with being a Test cricketer.
Probably the main recognition that I've got from that came from Nick Hancock this year when he selected me in his dullest, most boring and least charismatic England 11, which I was very pleased with.
I'd like to welcome everyone to the inaugural dinner of the One Test Wonders. And if everyone could be upstanding, we'll propose a toast. I propose a toast to the One Test Wonders.
This year, there are two new candidates, Simon Brown and Robert Croft. Whether they will be presented with their One Test Wonders tie lies somewhat in the hands of the club's president and England selector, Graham Gooch.
There is times when injuries happen and you bring someone in as a replacement and the other guy gets fit again and comes back and they don't get another chance. So I'd like to think that it's not the norm, although this sort of peculiar situation is going to happen, it would probably just swell the numbers of the club.
Well, the One Test Wonder Club is certainly unique. You have no choice in joining it. You can't wait to get out of it. But there's one thing that they can never take away from them. Their England cap.
Well, that's it for this summer. I just hope you've enjoyed everything we've managed to bring you. Next year, of course, will be dominated by the battle for the Ashes. And we'll have full live coverage of that here on BBC television. Hope you'll join us then. Till then, goodbye.